Hi, welcome to Street Priest Ministries. I'm your host, Brother Jay, where we're taking the Gospels back to the street. Today's drive-through message is Age of the Beast. Turn in your Bibles to Daniel 2:14. All right, today we're going to discuss the Beast Kingdom and the Antichrist. We're going to touch on it. We're going to go to Daniel. Now, Daniel was third in power in the government of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar. So Daniel was a government official and a prophet to the nations of that time period, or around 500 BC. So we're going to go to Daniel. Now, to give you the backdrop, Nebuchadnezzar, who is a prototype of the Antichrist. You had many different Antichrists in there, but he was one of God's ordained despots that we talked about in some of my earlier teaching. I told you God sets up even evil kings, and he was definitely one. Earlier you read he threw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into a furnace of fire to burn them up because they wouldn't bow down to his false gods. So the man was nothing nice. He was a killer. And like I said, a prototype of the Antichrist for his world power. Now, he was over a kingdom called Babylon. Babylon was a great kingdom in ancient antiquity. If he was a study, the gardens of Babylon are very famous. It symbolized gold. The lion was its heraldry. And we're going to go and read this. 2:14. Okay, now he had a dream and he wants Daniel to interpret the dream. And he's threatened under the penalty of Persia, if you don't interpret the dream, I'm going to kill all the Magi, the magicians, the wise men. Daniel's called a Magi, a wise man. But of course he's of God, he's not a wizard in the sense of, but it's just the office that he's holding. And Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. He said under the edict of Nebuchadnezzar, he said, I want you to not only interpret my dream that I had, but I want you to tell me what the dream means. And the wizard said, man, how could we do that? Nobody's ever asked that. He said, no, you're not going to give me no false divination. You're going to tell me what I dream and the interpretation. So he said, if you don't, I'm going to kill you all. Like I said, he was a despot. And Daniel would have been killed too. He answered and said unto Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree hastily gone from the king? Arioch made the thing known to Daniel. Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time and that he would show the king's interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mikael, and Azariah. This is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He gave them pagan names. Daniel's name in his pagan kingdom was Belshazzar. Belshazzar, see. What they would desire, mercies of God. He's asking them to pray that God would show Daniel the dream and the interpretation of the dream. See, this is prayer is in alliance with the Word of God. Remember, we talked about the power of prayer. Get the video. You'll see this pattern over and over again. Daniel's not praying for a new Cadillac. Well, I guess in this day it would be a new chariot with six horses, brand new chariot. It's praying for divine instruction. Thought I'd throw that in free. That God, that they would desire mercies of God of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was a secret revealed in Daniel in a night vision. God answered his request, his prayer, the power of prayer. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changes times and seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings." Remember, I've told you that over and over again. God's the boss of this earth. He sets up kings and puts down kings. He got clocks set on kingdoms. We're about to find this out now. We're about to read about this. "And he giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge unto them that know understanding." Now, Daniel was the wisest man in the kingdom. "He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in darkness." Say that again, slowly. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in darkness. Dark, there's nothing hidden from God. He knows what's in darkness. There's no dark secret, nothing hidden from him. Matter of fact, Jesus said, what I whisper in your ear shout on the rooftops. What I tell you in darkness, that you speak in the light. There's nothing hidden that shall not be revealed, the Bible says. "He revealeth the deep secret things. He knoweth what is in darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. I thank thee and praise thee, O thou God of fathers, of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might and has made known to me now what we desire of thee, for thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter." So he revealed him, gave him revelation of the dream. "Therefore Daniel went unto Arioch, whom the king had ordered to destroy. The wise men of Babylon. He went and said thus unto him, destroy not the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will show unto the king the interpretation. Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste, and thus unto him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah that will make known unto the king the interpretation. The king answered and said unto Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, art thou able to make known unto me the dream which I have seen and the interpretation thereof? He said, man, can you tell me this? You're going to tell me the dream and the interpretation? He wanted to be clear, because remember, your head's coming off if you don't get it right. Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king have demanded cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers show unto the king. He said, none of these magicians, soothsayers, wizards, sorcerers can show you this. Only me, only God ordained me to show this to you. This is coming from the finger of God. They're coming from falsehood. That's why he's going to kill them all. He said, if you don't tell me, I'm going to kill you. Because I know you guys, you're going to come here and you're going to BS me. He said, I ain't in the mood to be BS. I want to know this dream. So God gave his man revelation. God reveals things to his children, gives them revelation. Matter of fact, in the New Testament, it said out of the babes, they would dream dreams in the last days, and out of the babes, God would make his revelation known in these last days. A lot of that's going on. Children revealing prophecy through the power of God. But there is a God in heaven. Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secrets which the king have demanded cannot the wise men, the astrologers and the magicians and the soothsayers show unto the king. But there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. That's in our days. Thy dream and thy visions on thy head upon thy bed are these. As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon the bed, which should come to pass hereafter. And he that revealeth the secrets maketh known to thee what shall come to pass. For as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I might have more than any living, but for their sakes they shall make known the interpretation of the dream, and thou mightest know the thoughts of thy heart. Daniel said it's, you know, it's not because God want to show off his power through me. He said, but this dream is very important. In other words, this is a historical fact that's going to happen. And God just used you as one of his revelatory subjects to bring it to pass. Thou, O king, saw us, and behold, a great image. The great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee. And the form thereof was terrible. The image head was of fine gold, and his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet, that were of iron and clay, and break them to pieces. Then the iron and clay, the brass and the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream. We will tell the interpretation thereof to the king. The first world empire, Babylon of the Nebuchadnezzar. Thou art king, or a king of kings. So he's telling him, you're the head. God has set a divine clock on this kingdom. And he's saying, you're the head of the kingdom. And the clock begins now. This is the age of the beast kingdom. Starting here with Nebuchadnezzar as the head. You're the head of gold. Thou art the king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom. Who gave it to him? Who gave it to him? Have given thee a kingdom, power and strength and glory. And whosoever the children of men dwell, the hearts of the field and the fowls of the air, have been given unto thy hand, and have made thee ruler over them. Thou art the head of gold. Now I'm going to stop there and just speed this up. Now he's the head of gold. The next empire that came after the Babylonian Empire was the Medo-Persian Empire. Iran and Iraq. The Medes and Persia. They conquered Babylon after him, after Nebuchadnezzar. Cyrus the Great. Then you had, after the Medo-Persian Empire, you had the Gregorian Empire. Alexander the Great's kingdom. That represents where you had the, well, I'll go back here and read it for you. You had the head of gold, and then after that, you had the silvers, the arms of silver, breastplate of silver. That's represented the Medo-Persian Empire. Then you had the brass kingdom. That was the following. Shoulders of brass. You had the brass kingdom that represented Alexander the Great. Then you had the iron kingdom, which represented, after Alexander the Great's empire, the Roman Empire under Julius Caesar. And then you had the breakdown of the statue that went into the ankle, which represented the Ottoman Empire. And then the ten-toed kingdom is referred to in Revelations of the revised Ottoman Empire. And then out of that comes the Antichrist. Now I just gave you. And then you had the stone cut out without hands. That's Christ's kingdom that smashes this image and sets up his kingdom. Christ is going to set up his world order. And it's called the millennium. And then that's after the tribulation and the great tribulation that you read about in Revelation. Now, I just gave you 70 lead boots. It's like you paint with broad strokes and then you You fill in the detail. So now we're going to go to Daniel 4. Daniel chapter 4. Well, you know what? I'll skip that. Just tell you that he let Nebuchadnezzar know. Nebuchadnezzar became uplifted in pride. Well, okay, let's read about that because we just taught on that, didn't we? Take a look at Lucifer. So let's see. Yeah, I would read a little bit of it. Why not? Let me see. Let me start here. Now, God's going to physically remove him from his throne, going to turn him insane and going to make him turn him into a beast and drive him out into pasture to eat with the beast because he came uplifted in pride. And he forgot that God gives the kingdom of men their power. So he became uplifted in pride and said, I've heard that before. Take a look at Lucifer. Let's take a look at Lucifer. And so we're going to see this here. Okay. Now, he had been warned of a dream. And in the dream, he's seen this, that God had stripped him of the kingdom. He was driven out as an ox. His nails grew super long. And he became a madman. And there's a period in history, this is a historical fact, when Nebuchadnezzar went mad. It's recorded. So this is a historical fact. Sometimes everything could be looked up and verified. All right, it says here, verse 4:22. If thou art king, thou art grown and become strong, for greatness is grown and reacheth into heaven, and thy dominion to the end of the earth. Whereas the king saw a watcher and a holy one coming down from heaven, and saying, hew the tree down and destroy it, yet leave the stump of the roots. Hold on, I'm going to skip that. The king, and at the end, okay, a year went by, verse 29. So 4:29. At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. Now, he had been warned a year ago. God gave him a warning. He threw the dream. If you become uplifted in pride, I'm going to take the kingdom from you and drive you out with the beast of the field. Get it, beast? At the end of the 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. The king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have, here we go. Can't help it. These despots can't help. And said, is this not the great kingdom of Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by my might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? While the words was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to thee is spoken, the kingdom is departed from thee, and they shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beast of the field. He became a real beast for being uplifted in pride. Now, this is the first beast, Nebuchadnezzar. We're going to get to the bigger beast in a minute. Now, Daniel 5. We'll start here. Now, Nebuchadnezzar, he did come back to his senses and he died, and now his son has taken over, Belshazzar. Belshazzar the king made a great feast to the thousands of his lords and drank wine before the thousand. Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, commanded to bring the golden and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem. Now Babylon had burned Jerusalem, but God used Nebuchadnezzar as a rod to punish children of Israel for idol worship, Baal and Asherah. So they were living in exile, the Jews in Babylon, and were captured by Nebuchadnezzar. And the vessels of the temple, the gold and the silver vessels used in the Levitical codes for the temple was brought to Babylon. Now his son Belshazzar was going to take these sacred instruments that was used in the temple for God's sacrifices of various sorts. And he's going to take them and use them in his orgy. He's having an orgy right now with wine and the party and the drugs. They had drugs back then. Mandrake, poppy plant was around, the coca leaves. I mean, they're getting high, drinking, and praising their false gods. And this is going to piss the God of heaven off. Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, demanded to bring the golden and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes and his wives and his concubines might drink to him. Then they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple of the house of God, which was in Jerusalem. And the king and his princes and his wives and his concubines drank in them. They drank and praised the gods of gold and silver and brass and iron of wood of stone. They praised dead objects. In the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against the candlestick up on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. And the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Then the king's countenance was changed, and his thoughts and his loins were loosened. His knees wobbled. His knees buckled. He pissed on himself. And his knees smote one against one another. They knocked. He was so nervous. A giant hand. Picture a giant hand. Picture the hand the size of your wall. And his fingers writing something on the wall. The king cried aloud to the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the sorcerers. Here we go again. So he did like his dad. He went to the magicians, the household magicians, soothsayers, astrologers, but they couldn't help him. So I'm going to speed this up. So Daniel comes in, and he asks Daniel, just like his father, his wife, I think, the queen, reminded him that there's a man of God in the kingdom that can interpret dreams and tell you the dreams, too. Because, Daniel's fame, it went out throughout the country. Like I said, he was third in line in the kingdom anyway. He was like a vicer. So anyway, he commands for him to be summoned to bring the king. And Daniel tells him the interpretation of the dream. And this is where we're going to skip all this other stuff. Because Daniel scolds him and reminds him, remember your dad got uplifted in pride and what happened to him? Here you go again. I'm thinking you can do anything you want, but your God's going to check you. You can't do anything you want. God got checks and balances in his program. When you get too far out there with your ego. Then Daniel answered and said before the king, well, let me skip over here to verse 25. We'll start up with 25. Just give me 23. But thou hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven, and thou hast brought the vessels of his house before thee. We're at 5:23, by the way. And thou hast brought the vessels of his house before thee, thou and thy lords and thy wives and thy concubines, have drank wine in them, And thou hast praised the gods of silver and of gold and of brass and of iron and wood and stone, which cannot see nor hear nor know, and the God in whose hands thy breath is, and whose are thy ways, hast thou not glorified. Said the living God you have not glorified, but you glorified these dead objects, these idols. Then was the part of the hand set from him, and this is the writing, and this writing was written, and this is the writing that was written, meaning, tekel upharsin. This is the interpretation of a thing, mean. God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. He said, your kingdom, Babylon, is numbered and finished. Like I said, God sets up kingdoms and he takes them down. It's the end of your kingdom, pal, because of this one act you just did. And finished it. Tekel, thou art weighed in the balances and found wanting. You're coming up short. See, Babylon was under that perfectionism. If your good deeds outweigh your bad. Well, that's what he was speaking their language. Pires, the kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Now, there was a double prophetic message within what we just read, meaning, tekel upharsin. Now, that was a monarch. That was a coin currency of that day for the Persians. So that had a double meaning. And I'll give you an example, something you can understand in English. A thousand pennies equals $10, right? So that was equivalent to pennies in that day. So what he basically said, 1,000, meaning, 1,000, 1,000, that's 2,000. Now, imagine we had 500 nickels. Excuse me, 100 nickels, I'm sorry. 100 nickels, 5 times 100 is 500 pennies. So that would be 2,500. And add 2 dimes to that. 2 dimes is 20 pennies. So you would have 2,520 pennies. But God was interpreting that as years. 2,520 years. This was God's divine clock that he set on his beastly kingdom, age of the beastly kingdom, starting with Nebuchadnezzar. That's divine. God Bible said 1,000 years is the Lord, it's a day, and a day is 1,000 years. God has a time set. He's a God of order. I've said it over and over again. So this is his divine clock set on his BC clean. Now, approximately 536, the Babylonian kingdom fell to the Medes and the Persian Empire, approximately. Give or take a few years. But if you deduct, subtract 536 from 2,520, I'm going to let you do it. I'm not going to tell you the answer. This is your homework assignment. Tell me what you come out to. And within a year or two or three or whatever of that, you're coming up on what God was talking about, the end of the age of the beastly kingdom. Now, you had a lot of false prophets that had been prophesying, not understanding that the Middle East is where it all began, and it's all going to end there. They done, you had a false prophet, not going to, I don't name drop, but he sold millions of books. This guy was one of the biggest false prophets ever, and he named the ten-toed kingdom is being over in the European common market. And it's New York, I believe he said, with Babylon. And all, he was off on everything he said. He even, I think I'm not mistaken, made a prophecy of the end times in the 80s. This false prophet. Sold millions of books on major religious broadcasting networks and heralded as a prophet. He was a false prophet. I'm not going to mention his name, but you know who I'm talking about. And it's been several others because they don't understand history. They don't understand geography. Everything's returned into the Middle East. And that's where all these kingdoms that I just mentioned was in the Middle East, every single one. Now, we're going to go from here. Now, we're going to get into the man of sin himself, Mr. Antichrist. All right, so turn in your Bible to, let's go to Daniel once again. We'll go to Daniel, verse 5, chapter 5. I think it's 5. Let me see if it's not, it's 4. Now we're going to, he mentions the Antichrist here in Daniel briefly. And I didn't mark it, excuse me. Now, he calls him the little horn. And this is Daniel chapter 11. Verse 16. We'll start at 17. So, chapter 11, verse 17. He shall also set his face to enter in the strength of his whole kingdom, an upright one with him. Thus shall he do. He shall give him the daughter of women, corrupting her, for he shall not stand on his side, neither by him. After this he shall turn his face to the isles and shall take many, but a prince of his own behalf shall cause the reproach offered by him to cease without his own reproach. He shall cause it to turn upon him. Then shall he set his face toward the fort of his own land, but he shall stumble and fall and not be found. Then shall stand up in his estate a raiser of taxes in the glory of days of the kingdom. A few days he shall be destroyed, neither in anger nor in battle. Now we're going to get to the little horn. This was just talking.